So I'm David Johnson. I'm an assistant professor with a joint appointment in the political science department, primarily because I do a lot of environmental policy work. I previously worked at the RAND Corporation as a mathematician, which is where I also got my own PhD in policy analysis, but my background is bachelor's and master's in math. And I'm going to talk a little bit about a couple of different projects that I have going on at the moment. In different areas, but all sort of related to environmental decision-making for policymakers that are thinking about long-term resilience of infrastructure in the face of deep uncertainty about climate change, population growth, and other factors, kind of over a long planning horizon. So a lot of my work is in coastal Louisiana, where I've been working with planners there actually in the state government for about a decade now, since around 2009. And I essentially built the flood risk model that the state uses to decide where to build new levee systems or where to provide funding to elevate people's houses to try and reduce the risk of flooding to prevent another hurricane like Katrina from causing as much damage as it did. So for the master plan work, this is a 50-year, $50 billion plan that the state developed after Hurricane Katrina and Rita hit in 2005. And it's designed to combine flood risk measures to manage flood risk with other measures designed to prevent land loss and restore the wetlands in coastal Louisiana, and to try and balance those competing objectives of reducing flood risk as well as restoring land and preventing land loss. So this is kind of a big integrated simulation model that we have where we're not only modeling what the future landscape might be with different projects like river diversions or marsh creation projects in place to try and restore the wetlands, but then thinking about if a future landscape looks a particular way, then how does that impact flood risk? When climate change is going on, when population is shifting from rural areas to more urban centers, and when you have uncertainty about things like the chance that levees could fail again, like they did during Hurricane Katrina. And so this is a big kind of multi-objective optimization problem that also has elements of deep uncertainty, meaning that there are certain uncertainties about our system that we can't model using a classical probability distribution function. And they're just not a classical stochastic process. And so when you don't have a probability distribution, you can't calculate an expected value and try and optimize an expected response. And so the problem for decision makers is then, how do you still make a good decision? How do you still make a good policy that's going to be cost effective and achieve the goals that you have for your plan when you can't predict what future conditions are going to look like, when you can't even calculate an expectation? Okay, so this is kind of a common theme in a lot of my work, is that we're thinking about some sort of multi-objective policy problem where there are trade-offs between those objectives, and we need to account for the fact that we don't know about what the future is going to hold in our system, of what future conditions are going to be exposed. So we don't necessarily know what sea level rise is going to do over the next century. There are a lot of different scientific groups that are trying to model sea level rise under different future conditions. Those competing models give us different answers. So one model might give us a PDF of sea level rise over the next 100 years, but we don't know which of those models is more correct than others, right? So we have competing models that need to just be treated kind of using scenarios. And for this type of work, we might be running scenarios or hundreds or thousands of different combinations of future scenarios. So different combinations of things like sea level rise, trajectories, the probability function representing like the chance that levees would fail, population growth scenarios, scenarios about whether or not hurricanes become more frequent or more intense in the future than they are today, and try and identify policies that are going to reduce risk effectively, that are going to restore land effectively, and that do that across a wide range of those future uncertain scenarios. So that's a concept of robustness that we use, of trying to identify policies or solutions that are robust in the sense that they perform pretty well, they're kind of close to optimal across a wide range of different future scenarios. Okay, so that's kind of the key behind a lot of the decision support that I do with government agencies or when evaluating other potential policies. So another application of some of the work that I'm doing now with one of my students is on biofuels and looking at the potential to co-fire corn stover or biomass. So corn stover is basically everything that's left besides just the kernels of the corn. Okay, so the cob, the stalks, the leaves, all of that, that would get harvested and then sort of just left on the field as a residue to enrich the soil if you are just trying to harvest the kernels of corn to make ethanol or to use for livestock feed or other purposes. Okay, so corn stover is all the leftover parts of the corn plant. And what you could potentially do is take that biomass and fire it in existing coal power plants and use that as a fuel instead of coal. Okay, so most power plants, you can repower them to get about 5 to 20% of your energy from biomass without having to make any big changes to your boiler designs. Okay, so it's technically feasible. There are some incremental operations costs associated with processing the biomass to go into the boiler at the same time that you're using coal, but it's technically feasible. And so potentially this would represent a way for you to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions associated with producing your energy, okay? Over the long term, we probably want to move away from coal entirely, but in the short term, we have these existing plants that are not necessarily close to their end of life. So this would be a way to reduce the emissions intensity of existing power plants while they're still in operation, okay? And so one of my students was looking at what's the implied abatement cost associated with using that strategy? So if we're thinking about an abatement cost, we're saying, how many dollars is it going to cost you to reduce your emissions by 1 ton of carbon dioxide, okay, by using corn stover instead of coal? So we did an analysis looking at 83 different coal power plants that are in the Midwest. So there's a lot of overlap between the Corn Belt, states that produce a lot of corn in the US, and states that rely heavily on coal energy. Okay, so potentially this would be a good fit to use corn as your source of biomass. And so we looked at these 83 different power plants across the Midwest and analyzed what the associated abatement cost would be in terms of dollars per metric ton of CO2 that are reduced in your emissions while maintaining the same level of energy production. And found, this is a little bit small, but zero is this line here. And for most power plants, there's kind of a range of abatement costs, or there's a lot of variability across the 83 power plants that we studied in terms of what the abatement cost would be. The y-axis here, the three different charts, this is if you get 5% of your energy from coal, 10%, or from biomass rather, 10% and 20%. And so what you can see generally is that there's a pretty wide spread of abatement costs, ranging from some power plants where the abatement cost is actually negative, meaning it could potentially actually save you money to use biomass instead of coal, and others where the implied cost is up to almost $200 per ton of CO2, which a lot of studies are estimating that kind of the social cost of carbon, the price that you might set a carbon tax in the US would be somewhere in the neighborhood of around $40. And so if the abatement cost is higher than that and a carbon tax was put in place, people would rather just pay the tax, okay? Whereas if your abatement cost is less than some sort of a carbon tax or kind of a price on carbon, then producers should in theory be willing to pay to use biomass to abate their emissions and avoid those emissions in the first place. And so what we found is that there's a lot of variability. Generally, your abatement costs go down if you use a higher percentage of energy coming from biomass, which sort of makes sense that you would think that if there are some fixed costs associated with using biomass, then if you use more biomass, you're kind of spreading those out. The fixed costs get spread out over a larger quantity of biomass and thus a larger quantity of emissions that get avoided. And we found that the abatement costs are generally driven more by the power plant's characteristics than the characteristics of the biomass. Okay, so we're taking that analysis and trying to expand it across the entire US and to look at other biomass feedstocks like forest residues as well. Okay. Some other work that I do, this is not actually hooked up, there we go, is working with some ag economists here at Purdue, as well as some other climate scientists, some hydrologists, kind of a big team that are known as the Purdue Glass Institute, which is Global to Local Analysis of System Sustainability. And so what we're looking at is basically trying to evaluate what's the long-run sustainability of agricultural practices in the US under future climate challenges. So this is based on the UN Environment Program's Sustainable Development Goals for 2030, which they have a set of roughly 20 different sustainable development goals, and about half of those have something to do with land use or water or food production or energy. Okay, and so there are trade-offs and there are interactions between food, energy, and water systems that we're trying to model on a global scale at a very fine resolution so that we can understand if you use or adopt different policies to try and manage negative consequences, like, for example, hypoxia in the Gulf of Mexico, which is caused by fertilizer runoff. And it kills a lot of the life in the Gulf of Mexico and depresses fishery outputs. Okay, so if there's a lot of nitrogen fertilizer applied here in the Midwest, it eventually leaches or kind of filters into the Mississippi River, runs down the Mississippi River to the Gulf of Mexico, and causes huge problems in the Gulf of Mexico. So this is kind of a regional to almost national scale issue. And you might try and limit hypoxia by setting a policy that prevents you from applying as much nitrogen fertilizer to crops. If you reduce fertilizer usage, that's going to have an impact on your yields for corn. You won't be able to grow as much corn or soybeans for the same amount of land because you're reducing your inputs. If you do that, then to try and counter the reduced yields, you might think about applying more water or irrigating more to compensate or planting more acres of land in the first place. And so if you do that, then maybe you can get your production back up to normal levels, but now you're using a lot more groundwater. It might be unsustainably using irrigation, or you might be planting on marginal land that could be better used for other purposes. And so there are interactions basically between the food, energy, and water system that are inextricably linked. And any policy that you put in place to try and solve kind of one of these challenges is going to have impacts on the others as well, okay, and the rest of the system. And so we have a big team of researchers here at Purdue that are trying to identify what the trade-offs are associated with different agricultural practices and understand how we can develop combinations of policies that avoid a lot of these negative externalities and allow us to still feed a growing planet over the years to come without all of these bad consequences occurring, okay? And then finally, I'll just kind of mention another area of research that I've been working in, which is managing water scarcity. So I've been working with some water agencies in California to think about managing drought, okay? And this is another example where we've got deep uncertainty about future climate conditions, temperature, precipitation, snowpack during the winter. And we have uncertainty about population growth in this part of California that I'm working in, which is kind of just east of Sacramento to in Northern California. And so this water agency was looking at a range of different policies to try and manage their future supply. Everything from building a new surface reservoir to expanding their gray water recycling program to implementing efficiency measures like subsidizing people to get low flow shower heads or dual flush toilet systems that save water, as well as some other measures. And they wanted some systematic way to evaluate what the different values of using different combinations of strategies would be under different future conditions, okay? And trying to identify a robust set of options. And so we again use this robust decision-making, decision support tool and method that was developed at RAND Corporation where I previously worked, where I'm still an adjunct. And we apply this kind of robust decision-making to a lot of different environmental problems, or it doesn't necessarily have to be environmental. That's just kind of the area of research that I typically work in. But it allows you to essentially stress test policies by running over a large set of scenarios. So you need a physical model or simulation of your system that's relatively quick and computationally efficient. And you might run it hundreds or thousands of times with different combinations of policies in place. And then for a given policy, you use statistical analysis to identify what are the deep uncertainties in your system that are mostly responsible for your policy succeeding or failing. And for the key uncertainties that you do identify as causing vulnerabilities in your system, what are kind of the critical thresholds beyond which you start to see more failures than successes from your policy? And then once you've identified those thresholds, you go back to your decision makers and try and iterate and come up with what's a better strategy? How could I tweak this strategy just a little bit to make it less vulnerable? And so this is not an algorithm. It's not an optimization technique. It uses those as part of a decision support process. So this is kind of an area of operations research and decision analysis where you're generally going to be working with decision makers or with stakeholders together to try and identify a strategy that's consistent with their preferences and robust against a wide range of future conditions. And like I've kind of illustrated, it can be used in a range of different applications, but generally what we're looking for are systems where there's a complexity to them and that it's difficult to predict what future outcomes are going to be without actually kind of running a simulation of this system, where you have multiple competing objectives and where you have deep uncertainties about what the future is going to hold. Okay. All right, so I think maybe if there's time for a question or two while Brandon is coming in next, but otherwise I'll just say thanks very much.